live from Station 31. I'd like to introduce you to our newest engine here, Engine 337. It is a Timberwolf made by Rosenbauer, mounted on an International chassis. Basically, all I want to do is just give you guys a good walk around, kind of get you familiar with the outside of the rig today. So, as you can see, we do have a, we'll start here with the booster reel. We're going to move around to the front bumper area, where you'll notice there's a turret, task force turret. We have a 200 foot cross lay in here. We're all familiar with the way that we load our Minuteman loads. That's the way this is loaded up, 200 feet. It actually deploys from the other side, but I just wanted to show you this side first. Battery compartments, won't have to do much with those. But if you're interested in seeing where the batteries are at, there they are. This is the other side of that pre-connect where you'll see we deploy it from. Essentially the way it's loaded, there is a handle on there. We fold it back up in there for storage purposes, but you do the same thing. You put this on your right shoulder, grab your tail, stretch it out and go. When we load it, we fold the tail back up over there, Velcro back on, and make sure this is centered. NFPA will yell at us if we don't do that. This is a four-wheel drive vehicle, therefore it does sit a little bit higher than average, so I want to bring that to your attention because you'll notice there's two sets of steps on here. So when you get out of this rig initially, be thinking about it. From here down to the ground is about 3 feet, so make sure you hit this step. 3 points of contact on the rig is when at all possible. Don't make sure the brakes are set before you leave. This does have a DEF tank, which is diesel exhaust fluid. 331 has it. Both of the new tenders have it. We now have it on this one, so we need to make sure we keep an eye on the DEF gauge in there to make sure that it never runs out. Something that we'll do during the day maintenance for the most part, you shouldn't have to deal with that. You will, however, be filling it with diesel fuel. It does, the diesel, you just remember right, let the pressure out here, all the way back on. If you make a mess with this, please grab a wipe and wipe up the residual because it's gonna grab dust. That's how you fill it. This one is also unique to us because it's the only auto eject port that we have. There's actually a little pin in here that if you start this vehicle up with it still plugged in, it'll kick the plug off. We'll make sure to include a demonstration on that later on in the video. Moving on to the other hose reel, I'm gonna go into a little more detail on this one. It's the same as the other side. The only difference is this one actually is a wider hose reel, I think, that I believe has another 50 feet of hose on it. In order to make this thing work, as you'll see later in the pumping instructions, once this is charged, you have to activate it by turning this valve on and off. This valve is what charges up this hose reel. Then you can use the handle on the actual gun. When it comes to rewinding, there's the rewind button. Try to do that with two people, one to manage the hose and press the button and the other one to feed it to them. It's a safer way to do it. All right, this is an empty compartment. This platform is nice to be able to reach the upper parts of this compartment. We are having shelving built, so once we do, you're gonna need that step to get to it. The safest way to get onto that is to use this grab handle to get to it if you need to get something high. Otherwise, you should be able to reach everything else on the ground. But please don't jump on and off of that. It's better to come off this step where you have a grab handle. If you notice here, it's got a slide out tray in it. We're reserving this space for extrication gear in the future. That's where the pump will sit. There will be a blowhard positive pressure fan right here. And other assorted tools up above as we deem necessary when we get this thing in service. When you want to close this one up, make sure you lift that step up. Every one of these roll-up doors has a lanyard on it to get it down to where you can actually reach it and finish closing it. The middle compartment over the wheel doesn't have anything in right now, but eventually we hope to have a tool board in here, much like you see on Engine 331 with our tools mounted horizontally, and you'll be able to open it and use both sides of it. Spare bottles, spare SCBA bottles. Only a single holder, not like 331 where it holds multiples. But we have four on here, two over each wheel. Back compartment. This is actually going to be our engineer compartment. Again, shelving being built for it, the hydrant bag is gonna live right here. But the engineer compartment on this rig obviously is gonna be closer to the pump, which we'll get to here in just a second. This will eventually house traffic control items, stop signs, safety vests, flashlights. I do want to reiterate at this point that we do pump this thing from the rear. If someone gets in the driver's seat, they need to be paying attention to the backup camera display up there to make sure they're not backing over somebody back here. They should be able to see you and hear you. Just always look in that camera before you move this vehicle. You don't know what's going on back here. Our pump is housed in this panel back here. Grab these two latches, let it go. It'll also provide a step to get back to that ladder box. Underneath this door, voila, our pump. Engineers, see the details later in the video on how to work this thing. Firefighters, this is the equivalent of one of our speed lays that we have on the engines. It's a cartridge load. Similar to the front, we fold the handle back over, load this on your shoulder, grab your handle and stretch it out. It is a cartridge load, much like 331, so we'll take the cartridge out, load it back up, put it in. We'll instruct everyone on how to do that later. Again, all these doors have sensors on them. This rig is not to move when the light is flashing, so we need to make sure when we close things that they're positively closed. That's not closed. Closed, you hear that click, and you see it at least horizontal. This is our 2.5-inch blitz line. Has a smoothbore nozzle on it. And then we have 750 feet of 3-inch supply line back here. When you put this cover back on, make sure it gets over these little tabs. Bring this over the top of this load. That way it doesn't get tangled up in it later when you're trying to deploy this. As soon as you let that bungee go, you've got free access to it. But it's just all in the details. It's about making sure that we don't set ourselves up for failure.
The box,
10-foot folding ladder, 3-section 22-foot extension, and a 10-foot roof ladder. This is a two-man operation. I can drag this thing out until another firefighter can grab the other. There's also 2 10-foot pike poles up here. When you're done with this, make sure it's latched positively. All right, we're now on the passenger side of the vehicle, which you notice is very similar to the driver's side of the vehicle. We have another rear compartment. This is where you're gonna find your chainsaws later on, your fuel, your generator, and all that good stuff. This is yet to be determined. Another box, looks like the other side. Repair bottles again. This will be our RIT compartment. It's going to be identified as RIT on here, and there'll be a Star of Life on here because we're going to keep medical equipment, which will lay out RIT bag, AED with a shelf, irons, water, med bag, everything else goes in this compartment. Up here in the front.
I was just inspecting.
What are you doing?
I'm just inspecting the.
Hydrant duty, buddy.
Oh man.
Get out.
No,
I was just. Sorry about that. What are you going to do? This is going to be our wildland compartment. You're going to find everything wildland in here. There's going to be the long tools sitting up here and all your short tools, Pulaskis, Hazel Hoe, that type of stuff. Extra forestry line down here, forestry packs. Basically, if you need something for wildland, it's going to be in this cabinet right here. All right, let's go ahead and take a look in this cab here. You'll notice right away, nothing works on this without the battery on. Another piece is the turn signal assembly, left and right. This is also your windshield washer controls right here and how you get to high beam and low beam. All right, inside cab controls. Start with the headlights over here. A stands for automatic, so you can leave it in that position most of the time, but if you need to turn them off, you can always go to the zero symbol. mirror controls for adjusting your two big mirrors, one on the left, one on the right. Mirror heat. If we end up in some cold weather and you need to defrost the mirrors. Lamp check is a feature that International put on here so that when you activate it, it will make the lights flash in a cycle. It'll show you your high beams are working, left and right turn signals, brake lights, and park lamps. When you're done doing your light check, just press it again and it'll stop cycling. Familiarize yourself at some point with the gauge cluster up here. Two things to note up here is to make sure your number one and number two, primary air and secondary air. Number one is your brakes, so you want to make sure that's full. If it's just throwing you an alarm, then pay attention to it. Number two runs your horn and all the other accessory air. And this, all right, on the right side of the column, this is a unique thing with the new International. They shift from up here on this little stick. It's literally a click up for drive, neutral, and down for reverse. Don't try and use it like a turn signal. It's not designed to move any other way. It's just a twist and turn, and there's a push button on here if you want to go to manual gear shifting. There's another little joystick right here. That works the controls that are up here on your LCD screen. You can cycle through all the vehicle information, check oil life, all of that good stuff. Probably not something you're gonna have to be dealing with, but if you're interested and you want to learn it, that's the back button. This is a push to select, and then it's a four-way to cycle through everything. All your heat controls, defrost, AC, all up here. Exhaust brake, engine fan. We're just gonna leave the engine fan on. It's better for cooling, but if we find ourselves in a really, really cold situation, we might wanna turn that off so we can get our temps up. This is our four-wheel drive selection. Right now it's in 4x2, which means two-wheel drive. That would be four-wheel drive. This is low range and high range. Normally it'll live in neutral, but if we're out pumping and rolling on a fire with the high pressure, we're gonna have it in low. All right, what we're talking about here is the pump controls and what you can and can't do from the cab. Basically you have a start and stop for the pump here. You have your emergency lights, which turns on all your red flashy lights. This is the remote button for the horn on the steering wheel. This symbol right here, which is a big tank with an arrow going out of it, is your tank to pump. That gets your tank water to the pump. This is a symbol for primer. We shouldn't have to use priming except when we're drafting, so you really don't have to worry about that, but you need to know where it's at if you're going to do some drafting. The purple engine symbol is actually for the pump. That indicates the high pressure, so that's what you're going to be working from up here in front of the cab. Or in the cab. And this is your tank fill. And as you can see, it's a pump with a little arrow going into a big tank of water. So that's indicating you're putting water into the tank. You cannot fill this tank unless you open that tank to pump, because it goes through the pump to get there. This gauge down here, in its current state, which is where it always defaults to, will show you your available tank water, which at this particular point in time is at 54%, just a little over half tank. We're sitting at 17% foam, which is indicated in yellow, and the one down here just stands for 1% mix. It's a fixed 1% mix. And over here is how much PSI we're generating out of the pump. Right now it's reading 13.2. That's a residual from the last time we pumped. It still has pressure in it. The same pressure gauge can be found up here, which will show you your real-time high pressure. An average pressure for us is gonna be somewhere in the 200 to 300 PSI range. Which for you engineers will note, you'll note that's a little bit higher than our standard because it's for wildland firefighting. The only other thing we didn't go over on this panel up here is there's the foam button. So if you want foam, that's what you hit. Just know that when you do it, it's going to inject foam into the system, and then it will have to be cleaned out at that point after we're done with it. The other four buttons on here we didn't talk about are your scene lights, and they're easily indicated here. This one faces forward. That's your front scene, right scene, rear scene, left scene. They're just a momentary click, and you'll get a little read back here that they're on. Turn it back off. All right, y'all, here's the turret controls. Probably for the demonstration, I'm gonna leave it in the cradle. If you look on this thing, you can see this is the normal position that it'll rest in. if we want to deploy this, first thing we do is hit manual deploy here, and you're going to see up here where it moves to. So I'm going to click it. You can see the lights are moving to what they call a 50-50 position. That means the turret is pointing straight out, and it's at about a 30-degree angle. Now, coming back to the stick, if I want to operate it from here, I can move it left or right. I can pull it. I can move the turret up or down. It's like airplane controls. Its back is up, forward is down. The trigger up here is activated with this switch in the far left position where it says trigger control. Now I have control over the valve. I can open the gun and close the gun from that trigger. If I want to just run it full time open, then I go all the way to the right, which is valve open. Middle position is valve closed. The park feature over here, when we're all done with our operation, if you hit park, it will automatically put itself back into a park position. I'm going to go ahead and hit it now, and then we'll show you the gauge. It'll start flashing like it's doing right now. It runs through its paces, and it'll eventually stow itself. And once it is there, it will stop flashing. And someday today. And it's got to be parked by now. So it should be parked at this point. If you look at the top of the stick, one thing I failed to mention is this is a rocker switch up here. Left will go to a fog pattern. Right will go to a straight stream pattern. If you need to disconnect this, it does have some length. You can move to either seat to use it. Depress that button, slide it back. When you put it back, you can see how there's two pins on the bottom here. They index into these two holes here. So line it up with those two holes, slide it forward. This little latch should grab it. Please stow this cable back away so it's not just floating around up here. While we're talking about this stuff, well, here's your siren. Everybody should know how to work the siren. And here's our radio. Everybody should know how to work our radio. All right, engineers, a couple additional features in the cab. We do have a backup camera here that will be on all the time. That might seem like a good idea. It's nice to see what's behind you. However, at nighttime, it might be annoying. You have the option of either using this feature to select different levels of brightness. It will get down there to what they call night 4, and then go back to day. It just cycles through those 5. If you don't want it on at all, just press off. In this state right here, even if I go to reverse, it will still come back on for me. So this is how I prefer to run it. You guys decide how you want to run it. The advantage to having it on all the time, and this is really important, so pay attention here. We pump from the back of this rig. It's a pump panel in a position we've never had before. There is a potential for somebody to get run over. That's why it's good for anybody sitting in this driver's seat to be able to see if somebody is standing back there at all times. We will develop an SOG on that, on how we're going to operate this thing under those conditions, but I just want everybody to really, really pay attention to the fact there could be somebody at that pump panel at any time. So utilize this camera. Moving on up here, this is your seatbelt minder here. We have somebody seated in all 4 of these positions right now. If somebody puts their seatbelt on, it'll click in green. And this thing will also beep at us until everybody's clicked in. So keep that in mind. We need to make sure everybody's belted before we move. And last but not least, you'll also notice there is Bluetooth connections around here. There's a cigarette plug, 2 of them in here. Eventually, we're going to put some Bluetooth connections back here as well, so that we can, not so much for us, but when we're out on conflag fires, we have means to charge our cell phones. A couple other things about our cab features here. One is this little joystick right here. This is actually for cycling through the different features you can read up on the LCD screen here on the gauge cluster. It's more for informative than anything else. But while we're here, this is our actual shift here. It does not push up and down or forward about. It's a stationary switch here. You turn it to get to drive, or you turn it down to get to reverse. If you want to manually shift it, you would put it into drive and you would push in on it to get to first gear on your gauge cluster up here. So you're going to have to sit in this seat and work with that thing to understand exactly how it works, but don't try and move it because it doesn't move, okay? All right, y'all, this is the procedure for putting this thing into gear and pumping it. Basically, you've already gotten in, you've made sure everybody's seatbelted, you've started the vehicle as we're started right now. If we want to get water to the turret, the first thing we do is hit the start button. You'll see these two lights come on, pump engaged and okay to pump. Get some tank water to the pump. Activate our high pressure. At this point, you have water at the front of the truck, as illustrated by me pressing monitor deploy on here, which again will bring us up to 50-50. And you'll see now, if you look out over the hood, we got water. I'm going to adjust the stream back to semi-straight. We got water. We're sitting at 70 pounds of pressure, just at an idle. At this point, I don't have any control over the pump. If I want to gain control of the pump, I have to put a foot on the brake, take the parking brake off. Now I can run the pump up. This is for pumping in a stationary position. Set the brake, put it into gear, into drive. I'm going to press this in once because I want to go to manual gear one. And then I'm going to come up here to low. And I'm going to put it in low. And what that'll allow us to do is it transfers the transmission into a low, to low gear so that we can crawl a little bit slower in a field. At that point, I can let my foot off the brake, adjust my stream to where I want it. And not go anywhere. There we go. Take my brake back off. We're moving. The faster I go, the higher the pressure goes. But we don't need to go very fast in a field to get enough water. There we go. This is how you pump and roll using the turret. If at any point you need to stop and re-hit a spot, you go ahead and stop. Put it in neutral. You can rev it up and get a little more pressure, clean up a hot spot. Do what you need to do. And then move on. Alright y'all, we're going to be pumping for structural pumping here, so I'm going to show you the procedures to do that. We can also pump wildland style back here, but this is the procedure for putting the pump in gear. This step comes down with these latches. Make access to your pump, get a good close up of this. Most of those same gauges you saw up in the front or back here, you'll see this interface looks very similar, but it has a couple extra buttons on it. Same type of gauge here, but it's showing a different screen because this is your pump discharge right here, and this is your pump intake. This is your governor controller right here for your pressure. The way we're going to use it is this. Same type of situation up front. You're going to hit start to put the pump in gear. You're going to give it tank water from the tank to pump. If you need to prime it, it's right here. If we're going to run high pressure, you didn't activate high pressure. Right now we're going to pump like we're going to be doing structurally. Essentially, you can see just with the pump in gear and an idle, it's sitting at 65 pounds. That 65 pounds will come out this discharge, the deck gun, which is back here. Deck gun. That pre-connect corresponds with the 2.5 that comes out the back. Rear left is right here. Rear right is right here. Rear speed lay is right here. That's our speed lay. If you want to get the bumper speed lay, this is your air actuated control for that. With the front cross lay or the bumper speed lay, you have to press and hold this until you get a green light on the open. It's hard to see right now, but it's in a closed position. It'll be green on the open if it's all the way open. All right, if we're filling this thing up, we can either fill through this 2.5 right here that has a valve. So you would hook up to your hydrant here, open the valve, and then come up to tank fill. And that will let you put water into the tank. This is our main intake for the pump, 6-inch. We can use our hard suction on top to draft through this point. But eventually we are going to buy an adapter that will adapt this down to 4-inch storage so we can fill through this. It'll fill faster. All right, so we have the pump in gear. We're ready to pump. We'll assume that someone has taken this discharge. I want to get it up to 130 pounds of pressure. Turn the dial until we read 130 up here. Once you're in the neighborhood and you want to set your governor, you press this button. Light this up, indicating that your governor is set. It'll stay that way until anything's changed. You can see it just moved off its position. Hit it again and reset the governor. Now we're pumping a hose line. If you need to go quickly down to idle, you can just hit idle and it'll get down to idle. So you got a manual, selection, idle, and then there's also preset. If I hit reset, it'll go up to a predetermined point. Which in our case today is about 145 PSI. Okay, so now, if we're pumping but we're not moving any water, it's good to use the pump cooler. We need to have this thing on. What they'll allow is water to recirculate through the pump so it won't overheat. Up on this display, we're gonna have to do this one in a second. From this point right here, if you cycle through this, you can get to, this is actually your engine temp up front on the main engine. That's your temp, that's your oil pressure. And that's our batteries. You can see there's little red lines up here. That red line is it's a limit. They don't want you going over that. So in the case where this thing started to get too hot, it's going to throw an alarm up here where it says engine status alarm. You're going to hear an alarm out of there. If you hear that alarm, you need to address it. If it happens to be because the engine is too hot, you can always run some cold water through the engine with the auxiliary engine cooler. That should bring your temps back down and take the alarm away. Same thing goes with the pump. If the
pump gets over a certain temperature, it's going to give you an alarm saying it's too hot, and it means you haven't flown enough water lately. That's where the pump cooler comes into play. These components right here can actually get really hot if we're not flowing any water. So be careful, don't burn yourself on it.
So at this point, we're also going to demonstrate the booster reel nozzles. They're a little bit different than what you've seen before. As you can see here, it has controls just like a regular nozzle would, and it has little symbols on here to show you what your pattern is. So you're going to want to get familiar with these, play with them a little bit. That's all straight stream, fog, you can see it by the V pattern there, and all the way open is spring loaded. That's a flush position. So if your stream doesn't look quite right, always try flushing it out. Got a handle to activate it, a little trigger. Keep in mind though, we're dealing with high pressure, so this thing's gonna have a little bit of kick to it. It's not something you wanna let go of. Although it will shut itself off if you lose control of it. That's the good part. All right, so to operate on the high pressure mode, in order to utilize this line over here, same sequence. We're gonna start the pump. We're gonna give it tank water. We're going to give it high pressure. At that point, we're now reading off of this gauge right here. So as you can see, it's sitting at 100 pounds. Back over to here, I turn it up, but I'm watching this gauge. Right now, we're set up on high pressure, which is the only pressure that will run these booster reels. They won't run on the low pressure side.
We're going to be going over it today. In the rear, you have the departing. Front end, you have the current.